Hey everybody, my name is Shelly Bailey and I'm here to talk to you guys today about Sol LeWitt. And we're going to talk about his art and explore it a little bit, talk about how he created his stuff and how we can use his artwork to really jump into some math concepts and do some arts integration and crossover with some curriculum with our students. So we're going to really get into this today, and I'm going to go over each of the different areas that we're going to study this related to math concepts with this art project that we're working on today. Come on, let's get started. Okay, your beginning assignment for this project has some very specific instructions, and we're going to start together by drawing two rectangles and one triangle anywhere on your page. That's up to you. The lengths of the sides of the triangle should be different, and there should also be four thick lines, each 1 inch long, drawn in one of the triangles. So take a moment, follow these instructions, and draw this directive. So here's my drawing of those instructions. So if you were teaching this to your students, you would want to take a moment to have all of your kids take maybe 2 minutes, 3 minutes to draw this, and then everybody show their work to show how different they all are. And it's a great lead in for the into the artist that we're getting ready to study, and his name is Solomon LeWitt. He is known as Sol, and he would write directions for wall drawings that others would then follow to create murals. So we're going to take a moment and look at some of his murals. Meet Solomon Sol LeWitt, born in 1928 in Hartford, Connecticut, and he passed in 2007. He was known for being a conceptualist artist and someone who was very innovative in the minimalist movement. Sol created in a lot of different mediums, including printmaking, drawing, and photography, as well as sculpture. He was very interested in creating wall drawings to where he would give someone a conceived set of guidelines and directives, and he would hand the instructions to someone and ask them to create what they saw in their mind. He was very entranced and enthralled with the idea that people interpret lines and shapes and colors differently from one another, and every mural that was created was different than the next because different people were always working on it. Many times he would create what were considered these wall scribbles because he would have to require many draftsmen to come in and fill in the areas for him. Let's take a moment to explore this piece of art right here. If we were given instructions to look at that piece and try and come up with the directions that Sol gave to someone else to create that piece, what do you think it would be? I could imagine that part of his directions said, create three curved lines. Make sure they're all different sizes, but they must touch one another. Make sure all three curved lines are thick and are different colors. It would be interesting to see with those same directions what you might create or how someone else might interpret that direction. If you're teaching students that are kindergarten to second grade, you can use directions by referencing color, number, length, position, some very basic two-dimensional shapes. They can also include references to terms that might describe some spatial relationships, such as above, below, between. Other masterpieces to bring up for your students to observe to kind of stimulate that mathematical idea would be Robert Selden Duncanson's Still Life with Fruits and Nuts. Show your students this painting and ask questions such as, how could you tell whether someone handed you a large nut or a small apple if your eyes were closed? Why do you think the artist organized the shapes in this way? Then ask questions or have students pose questions about the number of apples or grapes or currants and nuts, such as, is each piece of fruit countable? How does the number of each food item compare? Allow time for students to think about these questions and answer them, and maybe even sketch their own still life pictures and have them talk about their sketches in a mathematical way by describing how many circles they drew, how many red spots are there, how many pieces of fruit, is one larger than the other one, is one above or below, are the nuts between the grapes. These are concepts that are abstract and geometrical in nature that will help our students understand math concepts better when we can visually pair that with something to help them understand that. If you teach students in grades 3 through 5, you might could have students focus on directions with references to color, number, length, and two-dimensional shapes. Directions could involve measurements that can include fractions of a unit, as well as a reference to an area or a perimeter. Types of angles might also be included, and students can even exchange directions and create their artwork based on someone else's description. Other masterpieces to observe to stimulate these mathematical ideas should include possibly the vivid quilts of G's Bend in South Alabama. Show pictures of the quilts and ask students how the quilts compare to others they've seen. Have students to take turns describing the geometric figures in one of the quilts as listeners try to identify what the quilt might be depicting. Students can even create their own similar geometric designs with construction paper. You can also show students Sunday afternoon on the island of La Grande Jatte by Georges Seurat. His painting is one that they should look at from far away and then bring up some close-up images of the painting to show them how it is created by just dots. It's just millions and millions of dots. And you could talk to them about this technique being called pointillism or stippleism. And you could have the students maybe determine a method for estimating the number of dots needed to make this picture and present their findings to the class. Finally, for students in grades 6 through 8, they can focus on directions with reference to proportional relationships, special properties of triangles, and transformations. Additionally, students can explore the proportional relationships within a person's face. How widely set are the eyes? What is the variation among people's face lengths? Does it relate to the width of their faces? Have students conduct research on the internet in art books or experimentally by measuring the faces of people they know and combining their data. Next, have them explore the proportional relationships within the face in famous masterpieces. For example, students can compare the face drawn by Mary Stevenson Cassatt in Young Woman in Green with Pablo Picasso's Cubist painting, Woman in a Blue Hat. Students can also explore the caricature-like ways kabuki actors are portrayed in woodblock prints. If you wish to explore the idea of proportions and mathematical concepts in art further, you can look up The Vitruvian Man, drawn by Leonardo da Vinci, which is a beautifully drawn portrait of a man in the proportions of our body. However, there is nudity. You can find edited versions without his private parts, or you can find versions where he's wearing silly boxers or underwear to where you may feel more comfortable showing that image with your students without having a lot of snickering boys and girls in your class. Make sure that you look into the notion of the golden rectangle when you're studying this. Golden rectangles exhibit a special form of self-similarity. All rectangles created are created by adding or removing a square are golden rectangles. Key takeaways about the golden ratio describes predictable patterns on everything from atoms to the huge stars in the sky. The ratio is derived from something called the Fibonacci sequence, named after its Italian founder, Leonardo Fibonacci. Nature uses this ratio to maintain the balance, as well as the financial markets seem to as well. The proportion 1.618 is known by many names, including the golden mean and the divine portion. If you divide the female honeybee in a hive by the number of males in a given hive, you'll get 1.618. Sunflowers have a ratio of 1.618 between all the diameters of each rotation of the seeds. Try measuring from your head to your feet and divide that by the length from your belly button to your feet, and you should get somewhere in the area of 1.618. So what's next? So for you on this particular assignment and project or this workshop, what I'd like you to do is create your own SolaWit plan. Create some directions, giving yourself some prompts. Try not to think very hard about the end product. Just think about directions that you would give to someone, that you have so many rectangles or triangles or so many lines, how thick they are, what color they might be, if they're over or under or across or between. Think about those kind of directions. Think about the materials that you'll use. And then I want you to sketch out what it is you create.